plants need to know that it's cold so that they know what season they're in. So actually, plants want to produce their flowers in spring. And in that case, it has to have nice weather, so warm temperature, and also long days, so a long daylight time. But that's the same in spring and in autumn, actually. So the way that the plant can distinguish between these two is by knowing that spring is after winter. So if it can identify winter, then it knows that the warm period that comes after that is spring. We're trying to find exactly what is the sensing mechanism that plants use. And what we did is we use a model plant, which is called a Arabidopsis. So this is, it's a relative of broccoli and oilseed rape, but it's much smaller. And we have it in the lab, and we put it in basically a glorified fridge. It's a growing cabinet where we can control the temperature and we can control the light conditions. And so we put it in cold conditions and see what genes respond and how they respond. And we try different temperatures. But what we've been doing until now is using constant temperatures. So just put it at 5 degrees, basically, and see what happens. But what we did in the experiment that I was working on is actually take this plant and put it back out in the field and monitor the genes that we know are important as they're responding in the field. And so we actually put the plants in two sites in Sweden, so in North Sweden and South Sweden, and also here in Norwich. And we grew them over a period of a natural winter to see how those genes responded. And there were two genes that we were particularly interested in. One responds to cold by decreasing, and another one responds by increasing. And the one that decreases is called FLC, and that's known to be very important for this process of remembering the cold, because it's not enough to just sense that it's cold, but you also have to store that information until spring comes so that you remember it's been cold and now is when it's spring. And the other gene is VIN3, and that increases it during the cold, but it doesn't have the memory after the cold. So we looked at these two genes in the field conditions. We have more complex patterns. So actually, in the case of VIN3, for example, that would normally just start to increase over time, we found that it didn't start to increase at all until the temperatures every day started to be not go above 15 degrees. So the maximum temperature of the day had to be below 15 degrees, otherwise we couldn't see any of this gene, any VIN3 at all. And then as soon as the daily temperature dropped below that, we had a jump in this gene, which told us that in the field we have very different response than what we have in our usual experiments. And then we looked again back in the lab to try to understand why that's happening. So we found that this absence of these high temperatures is a very important signal for winter. For the other gene, FLC, which normally would just decrease at the same rate throughout winter, what we found was in the autumn, basically, when we had some low evenings, but during the day we still went above 15 degrees, the rate, the FLC was going down, but very slowly. And then as soon as we moved into this true winter, it started to go down a lot more quickly. But actually this behavior also depended on the site. So this was very obvious in Norwich, but in Sweden, where the temperature started to get lower much faster, we didn't see these two separate behaviors there. So it's very important when we're doing the studies to look at many different sites to get a full picture of how these genes are responding and how the plant is interpreting its environment. We made a mathematical model to try to understand how plants are sensing temperature. So what we did is we wrote equations for how we expect these genes, VIN3 and FLC, to be responding to the different temperatures. And we actually designed experiments specifically to assess how they will respond in constant temperatures and how they will respond in fluctuating temperatures, and then use that to parameterize our model so that we would get the correct behavior in the different conditions. But what we did as we were trying to do this is we started off saying, okay, there's one temperature sensor that's telling the plant it's cold. But actually, when we tried to make a model with this, we found that one temperature sensor is not enough. So we said, okay, maybe there's two. Again, that was not enough. So we basically found that we kept having to add more and more temperature sensitive steps in our model to be able to get the correct behavior. But actually, that's not that surprising, because temperature affects chemistry in general, biochemistry. So you can imagine that the plant will have a lot of processes that are naturally temperature sensitive. And so a lot of this temperature sensitivity could be used by the plant to get the right response rather than having a specialized sensor. Putting these plants out in the field, you'd think is quite simple because that's where they're normally growing, but we had to do it in such a way that we would not be affected by external parameters or external conditions, and just take the temperature and the light conditions. But actually, this is not really possible when you're putting the plants out in the field. So in some cases, we had grazing. We also had a snow cover of about a meter. So we had, there was a student there actually doing the experiments in North Sweden, and she had to dig through a meter of snow to get to the plants. So as you can imagine, this is very important as we're facing climate change, because the temperatures in winter are likely to get warmer. And so in some cases, the plants might find that, might not interpret the temperature as cold enough, and so might not vernalize for long enough. And so it might be that they won't have had a long enough period to flower. But actually, this is, let's say, the very simple prediction. But we made a mathematical model to try to understand exactly how this process works. And what we found is, depending again on the plant, but also on the temperature that we will get to. So if we start from a natural Swedish winter as it is now, but then just slightly increase the temperature, then the plants will actually vernalize even better. So that means the FLC gene that's supposed to decrease will decrease even faster. Because it's not just a simple a case of having cold. Different cold temperatures also have slightly different effects. So we have to make predictions specific to the different plants. In the case on the temperatures in Norwich, increasing the temperature a little bit would actually make the plants vernalize much worse. So the FLC would go down more slowly, and so also flowering would be delayed for that reason. So Arabidopsis is a lot simpler than crops. So actually, when we're trying to make the jump to make predictions in crops, we have to consider a lot of things. So for example, these two genes that I mentioned, there's only one copy of each in Arabidopsis, but there are many of these genes in our crop species. So then quite a lot of work has to be done in the crops to try to see what we can directly translate. But of course, the backbone of the system is likely to be the same, at least for some of these copies. So we can use it as a starting point and then add the complexity of the crops. To combat climate change, one thing that we could do is look at areas or plants growing in areas where the conditions are similar to what we expect them to be here, and try to see if we can grow those plants here. I mean, that could potentially work, but I think we'd have to look quite carefully just to make sure that other conditions that we find here, it's not just about the temperature. Another alternative is to breed plants specifically to be optimal for the conditions that we're expecting, and we have to start that before we actually get to these conditions. So it's something that we have to have a deep understanding of how the plant is sensing temperature, so that we can get exactly the right plants that will respond in the way that we want.